Hi everyone, welcome to the show. We have a better investor appetite into Thursday's US GDP report, some consolidation in cryptocurrency prices, a cautious rating for Tesla at Wells Fargo, and a buy rating for Coinbase at Goldman Sachs. Okay, so the week kicked off on quite a positive note for European and US indices. We've seen all three major US indices gaining on Monday, despite the wild weekend volatility in cryptocurrencies that we will, of course, talk about later in the show. The rising virus concerns in Asia, but also despite the Chinese crackdown on cryptocurrencies and on commodities. So they're not really fun, are they? The Chinese government announced they have zero tolerance for excessive speculation and stockpiling in cryptocurrencies, that to slow down the latest rally in commodity prices, which threatens the stability of economic recovery. So could this cool off some commodity prices, which went out of control recently? Hardly, apparently. COMEX copper futures, for example, dipped yesterday on the news, but they rebounded without too much damage in copper. We see, for example, that we haven't seen a pullback to the 50-day moving average, which has been acting as a solid support since a year now. Iron ore futures, on the other hand, are under pressure, but the retreat we see in actual price levels is relatively soft compared to the positive pushes we've seen since the beginning of this month. So for now, nothing too alarming for the commodity complex. We have such a light economic and corporate calendar this week that the investor sentiment is globally will be driven by the digestion of latest events rather than the new rebounds and drama, in my opinion. The most important event on this week's economic calendar is the US GDP release on Thursday, which should confirm a 6.5% growth in the US economic activity during the first quarter of this year. A robust growth number like this one should give a boost to the risk appetite, and all stocks should benefit from it, especially the technology stocks, which have been lagging their value peers over the past couple of weeks due to these inflation worries. And regarding this inflation issue, the Fed members have been saying and repeating again and insisting that the acceleration we see in consumer price inflation will be transitory and it won't last long. And investors seem like they are ready to give the Federal Reserve the benefit of the doubt, as that's the best scenario for an average investor, as it would also mean that the Federal Reserve's ultra-loose monetary policy wouldn't be threatened, at least in the short run. But we will still hear the tapering talk happen within the next coming meetings. Unfortunately, no investor will sleep on his or her 2 years until we see at least some stabilization in the inflation data in a month or two. So what does that mean for you? It really means that we will likely have a period into this summer where we could expect to see some increased volatility, with a higher risk of seeing significant downside corrections than price rallies on an index level. But who can ever rule out the possibility of Nasdaq renewing record yet again? Last week I was predicting a rise above the 50-day moving average in Nasdaq, which stands a touch below the 13,500 handle. We have a beautiful double bottom formation near the 13,000 psychological level as well, an expectation of a robust US growth data this Thursday, and ideally a robust read should give a hand to the Nasdaq bulls, in my opinion, and push the index to fresh records before the end of this week. After all, we are just some 2.5% off the latest all-time highs. Now, looking at the corporate calendar, Amazon is poised to announce the acquisition of MGM Movie Studio as soon as today. Nvidia and Dell are due to release earnings on Wednesday and on Thursday, respectively. Now, Nvidia is among my best stock picks, as you know, for playing the global chip shortage theme. So the results, Nvidia results, will likely reveal how well the company's done in the first quarter of this year. And the 4-for-1 stock split plan has as giving a boost to the stock price as well recently, as a lower stock price for Nvidia also means that the shares would be more accessible to a larger public. So that's positive. The split is yet to be approved in June and should be effective by 20th of July this year, but I see no particular risk here. Also, and also the strategic nature of Nvidia's plan to acquire the British Arm holdings is another positive factor for the stock price in the long run, although the deal is still subject to regulatory hurdles. Anyway, Nvidia is set to expand gains towards a fresh record to and about the $650 per share level if we see a good beat in the first quarter results this week. So elsewhere, the big tech favorites are giving out signs of some recovery. Tesla was up 4.40% yesterday, even after receiving a cautious rating from Wells Fargo in the first ratings outlook, as the stock looks pricey even after the latest pullback, and there are some long-term concerns that could actually limit the upside, according to them. So according to Wells Fargo, we also remember that the big shorts, Michael Burry, is also heavily short on Tesla, and we read titles like, oh, will the Tesla shares drop 90%? Well, of course, that's for making the buzz. Now, if you're looking on the CNN Money's price forecast, the average price forecast for the next 12 months for Tesla shares stands at $730 per share. That's some 20% higher than where we are right now. But the forecast range is quite wide, to be honest. The lowest forecast is at $67 per share. Yes, $67. And the highest end points at somewhere close to the $1,500 level. In the short run, I believe Tesla shares are not necessarily under a bearish threat and should continue their recovery toward their 50-day moving average, that's near $660 level per share. Then we could see the next sell-off force the price of a share toward the $500 handle in the continuation of the broader bearish trend, but not below, in my opinion, unless we see a dramatic change in the market outlook globally and the company's metrics. Now that we are talking about your bank ratings, let's have a quick look at Coinbase, which got a buy rating at Goldman Sachs on its business model, which thrives on elevated cryptocurrency volatility, sure. And that was exactly my first call. But after broader reflection, I became kind of more skeptical regarding Coinbase. There is more important thing to keep in mind here, and that's that the positive volatility is positive for Coinbase profits. That's a sure thing. But Coinbase earns great fees as people rush to buy cryptocurrencies. But the same may not be true for a long term market rose. A short-lived negative volatility is good for business because a wave of excessive sell-off in cryptocurrencies means more transaction fees for Coinbase. But then for the business to be and to remain profitable in the long run, people should come back and buy again. So that's the trick. That's the risk of a too much volatility in the market, and especially a too much downside volatility. So I keep my neutral view on Coinbase, which I revised from bullish a couple of weeks earlier, by the way, for the same exact reason than Goldman Sachs is bullish for, and watch the $200 handle. That could be a make or break price support for the medium run, in my opinion. Now, speaking of cryptocurrencies, as I promised, it's been a wild ride for Bitcoin over the past weekend. Bitcoin tested the $30,000 support and successfully held ground at this level. So, of course, with the latest plunge, we also see an increased number of negative reports, negative comments regarding what is to come. At this point, the future is still very much uncertain for Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies, of course, but in the short run, the $30,000 support will likely hold, and we could see some consolidation around the 200-day moving average, which stands a touch above the $40,000 level for Bitcoin. Well, when I say consolidation, we shall continue seeing a daily volatility near 10%, obviously, until the dust settles. But this week, especially this week, I expect to see a positive bias in the crypto trading, as we will hear many crypto supportive names such as Elon Musk, for example, Katie Wood or Ray Dalio speaking about cryptos at CoinDesk's four-day consensus conference. And we already heard Ray Dalio saying he would rather buy Bitcoin than bonds. Well, that's really not surprising, by the way, coming from him, as he's known to be quite bearish on bonds, right? But obviously, as those who participate to the CoinDesk's events are pro-crypto, what we will be reading and hearing in the headlines throughout this week will likely be positively skewed as well. So you should keep that in mind. But beyond this week, looking at how the markets reacted following following this type of price rallies in cryptocurrencies in the past, we will unlikely see another record run in the foreseeable future, in my opinion. I believe that any price rally in Bitcoin would remain limited below the $50,000 handle. If anything, Ethereum's on a right path in the actual environment of environmental concerns for cryptocurrencies, as it's shifting to the more energy efficient proof of stake protocol, which should decrease its energy consumption by more than 99%. Apparently, Goldman thinks Ethereum has the means to take over the reins from Bitcoin even. Well, I always believed so as well. Now I'm patiently following Elon Musk's tweets to see if he would give a chance to Ethereum to overshine the others, as the value we give to cryptocurrencies as a whole mostly depends on what he thinks. This is all for today. I'm Ipek Ozkardeskaya, and thanks for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and insightful to you. Please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your questions, and your reactions below, and also follow us on Twitter and on LinkedIn for regular market updates, and subscribe to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow, and until then, good day trading.